So for today's program, we'll start with Dr. Kelvin Montagu on soil moisture monitoring and irrigation management. Then we'll hand over to David Hunt from Greenlife Industry Australia on weight-based irrigation and leachate monitoring systems used in nursery. And then over to Dallas Gibb from Hitachi, Vantara, who will discuss visualising and interpreting moisture data and water banking irrigation, followed by a question and answer session at the end of the webinar. Please type your questions into the Q&A function as we go throughout the webinar. Just a very quick background on the project. So this project is named Digital Remote Monitoring to Improve Horticulture's Environmental Performance. And there's four main objectives of this project. First, to identify requirements of environmental management systems, such as fresh care, environmental and eco-hort, and see how they can be digitally collected. Establish four pilot sites to test the technology, to build a remote monitoring dashboard, which is the Hitachi control tower, and then communicate the benefits of remote auditing. There are quite a few partners in this project. So firstly, the project is funded by Hort Innovation through fundings from the National Landcare Program. Hitachi is a major partner. We have Fresh Care, Avocados Australia, Australian Bananas Growers Council, Greenlife Industry Australia, GrowCom, AusVeg, and Landcare Australia. These are the locations of the four pilot sites. So we've got a banana site up in Boogan, Queensland, which is near Innisfail, a vegetable site at Bundaberg, an avocado site at Bundaberg, and a production nursery in Torbenlea.
Thanks, Liam. My name's Henry. I'm just going to give you a brief overview of some of our upcoming communications activities. So this webinar is the first in a series of webinars on smart farming technologies. Our next webinar will be on the 11th of May covering dendrometers. And we'll also have a webinar later in May on nitrate leaching. And in late 2023, we'll have a webinar covering automated reporting through fresh care and eco-hort systems. Liam and myself will also be hosting a workshop at Hort Connections Adelaide. This will occur on the 6th of June from 12 to 1:30 p.m. And it will be a practical hands-on workshop covering the sensor technologies covered in these workshops, obviously these webinars. And we'll give people an opportunity to basically play with the sensors, see how to install them and interpret the data. We'll also be hosting a few workshops with David from Greenlife Industry Australia throughout the rest of the year. Some of our communication activities that we have already produced will be available on our website. These include the how-to guide, some of the fact sheets and case studies, including one that is linked to this webinar, and some grower videos that we filmed earlier this year. These will be distributed next week to all attendees. I'll now hand over to Kelvin to discuss soil moisture monitoring and irrigation management.
Thanks, Henry. So just a quick summary of what we've been up to in terms of soil moisture sensing, but also the wider understanding of crop water use. Liam, I think you're going to put the URL for or a link to this guide for smart farming and horticulture. And that gives us a bit of a summary on where we're up to with the project and some of the activities. I guess one of the key ones in there is that is smart farming right for you, and some key considerations there. So, you know, have a look at this document. You know, it'll give you an overview on smart farming. There's quite a few of these sorts of projects around now, looking at that sort of data integration and how we might use the technologies to help you with your management. The particular focus of this project has been around environmental reporting, and obviously we're operating in the reef catchments, so that's a priority. But you've got to be able to drive it through the productivity aspects of it as well. So some considerations there. Soil moisture and irrigation management, what's new? I've been involved with irrigation management and soil moisture monitoring for quite a while. Certainly my days go back to the neutron probe, where we used to sit out in the paddock and write it down on a bit of paper. So it spans a very large time, and also just the technologies. So the big things that I've seen changed in my career is the sensors have gone from research sensors through to now, they're now cheaper, more robust, and deployed into operational scale sensors. That's been one of the big things that's happened. But we've seen plenty of other things happen around satellites becoming higher resolution and multispectral. That's impacted on our weather forecasts, along with a computer grunt, so that we get far better weather forecasts, but also integrating the ability to monitor remotely, and then also tie that to weather models, so that we can start to estimate crop water use really well from satellite technology, something we couldn't do 20 years ago, even 10 years ago. In terms of the sensors, we've now got a lot of wireless internet of things. So, you know, cheaper sensors and integration are the real key ones that's developed over the last 10 years. So why monitor for your irrigation management? Well, first off, the demand varies a lot. And this is just two contrasting sites in Victoria. So Maffra on the coast, Sunraysia inland. And, you know, you can see clear seasonal variability there. During summer, demand's a lot higher than winter. So, you know, you're going from 2 mil per day up to sort of 10 to 11 mil per day. Seasonally, daily, if you look at something in Maffra, or out in Sunraysia, you're up at, you know, 12, 13 mil per day, down to 4 mil per day. So that variation between the day is quite a lot. So a lot of seasonal variation, a lot of daily variation, and a lot of variation between sites. So knowing how that's impacting on your irrigation management is important. The other one that varies quite a bit is obviously your crop as it grows. Variations in crop water requirement varies a lot. So, you know, just an example of what a lettuce crop looks like as it grows, but also underneath it here is a potato crop growing through here. Obviously, peak water requirements through here before it starts senescing. So, understanding weather, crops, you know, you can't just set and forget. I started off here in with one of these things, you know, still actually the gold standard of soil moisture monitoring. When you look at studies that calibrate all these other sensors against something else, it's often the neutron probe that's the core. And one of the key messages is that, you know, size matters. So the size of the soil volume that you're actually measuring really matters, and the soil neutron probe is still the gold standard against that we measure all these others off. But really, last couple of decades, lots of sensors, cheaper, more robust, but they're still high maintenance. You know, they're still not a set and forget thing. So we cover this in the guide, but selecting a sensor is obviously it's got to be compatible with your smart farming platform, and that's a major issue, and I'm sure Dallas will talk about that. You know, having different sensors coming into your platform is you know, conceptually very straightforward, but actually getting the communications is more difficult. We want communication in near real time. So we don't want something like in the old days where you put your sensors out and you might have a data logger attached to it, which was the next advanced aspect, but you had to go and download it and you know, that was not real useful from a management point of view. So communication in near real time, and now we've pretty much got that. You know, with the mobile phone technology, we can basically just be either downloading it in near real time or logging it over a day and then uploading it once a day, those sorts of options. Another important thing in selecting your sensor is local support available. You know, that things will go wrong and you'll need someone to come in and deal with some of those issues. So you need some local support. Cost and is both upfront and ongoing. You know, certainly 10 years ago, it was all upfront. Now it's upfront and ongoing through us. You know, some sensors now have us like a subscription model that covers both the communication costs, but also the ongoing cost. And, you know, you might run over it with a rotary hoe or it drops out, and some of those suppliers now have a subscription model where they'll come and replace the sensor. So looking at cost, but they certainly, you know, keep coming down. Selecting your sensors, depth and the number of depths you want will be a factor as well, both in cost and also the type of sensors you're putting in. Sometimes you might get away with two sensors, but if you're starting to want to go to more a water balance model, you're going to need, you know, 10 centimeter increments so that you can start to calculate the amount of moisture in your soil and start to build a water balance model around that. Ease of installation. Obviously, if you're in a short-term crop, like a veggie crop, you need to be able to get the sensors in and out, and that can be a major limitation. And finally, the soil volume measured. You know, I talked about the soil moisture, the neutron probe being the gold standard. You've got to look at what other options you've got. Some of the capacitance probes, you're only measuring a very small amount around the access tube. The TDR or frequency domain or the FDR type probes, you're measuring a bigger volume. So that's, you know, that's a benefit. I'm going to briefly just cover off on installation, but, you know, this is a major area in itself. Always look at the supplier's instructions. It's location, location, location. So work out where you're going to put them is important, both at the broader scale, so across your paddocks. You use your soil maps, satellite drones, any information you've got, plus your knowledge of the paddock. And then you'll think about where you put them within your rows, particularly if you've got drip irrigation, it's pretty important understanding where you're putting those probes. The number of sensors you're gonna put in your areas, the depth of placement, the timing of when you actually put those in, if you've got a perennial crop, is pretty important. You always generally want at least one of your sensors to be below the root zone so that you can start to look at fluxes below the root zone. So are you over-irrigating? Is water moving beyond the root zone? Really important, particularly if you're starting to look at things like nutrient loss and leaching below the root zone. So that's sort of covered off in more detail in the how-to guide, and go and have a look at those. I'm just going to run through some general sensor installation tips. Pretty important that before you deploy these into the paddock, make sure your sensors are actually working. So here I've got just a series of sensors. You put them all at the same depth and, you know, you want to make sure that they're giving sensible numbers. They're not going to be precise because even at that scale, you're going to see variation in soil moisture, but just make sure you check them before you actually go and spend the money putting them out in the paddock. Know where they are. We've all got GPSs on our phone. This is the one I use. You know, you're out in the paddock, you just push the button and then you email it to yourself and then you've got a record of where things are and where you've labelled them. So pretty straightforward. Pretty important that you know that they're out of the way. This is an example of a GPS monitor we had on the tractor, but this is one fertiliser application in a banana plantation. You've got to make sure your gear's out of the way. Down here, we've got the installation of a node, if you like, in Chile's. Again, you've got to make sure the spray boom will go over the top. The tractors will go around it, mark it out with some flags at the beginning and start of rows so tractor drivers know it's there. And within the nursery, David will talk a bit more about this, fitting it in so it's within the crop and it's not going to interfere too much within the operations. We talked about this well-marked sensors, basically having flags at the beginning and the end of the row so that a tractor driver knows it's there. Okay, at this stage, but, in a couple of months when the crop canopy's there, it can become problematic to actually find your sensors. Solar panels, make sure they're not too shaded. They're going to supply the sensors with the power they need. This is an avocado. It's obviously in bananas. They grow up pretty quick. So pretty high extensions needed. And also, you're in a tropical zone, so you're going to have some pretty severe weather events. So you need to be taking those into account. And finally, you need to be able to access some of this stuff. So if you've got a really high pole, you need to be able to bring it down and do any maintenance you need on it. So really practical stuff around there. It's all outlined in the manual, so have a look at that. I guess I've talked a bit about the sensors. They're cheaper, they're more robust, but they're still high maintenance. They're not set and forget. Even if they are really reliable, you're going to have lightning storms come through and blow things up. You're going to have, you've got techo out in the paddock, you're going to have ants getting into it. You're going to have all those issues that you've got to be able to manage. I guess really they were the, from when I started, that was the big advance. Sensors becoming cheaper and more robust, and I call it going from research to operational quality. We've definitely gone down that route. And then in the last 10 years, the real big jump has been in the communications, the real-time communication. So you can start to do monitoring and you're getting it to your mobile or into your laptop or into your desktop through the cloud. And so now, I can sit and monitor soil moisture from around the country. The next bit is, and Dallas will touch on this a lot more, is that integration and visualisation, and that's where we saw this project as being really important, starting to bring that information sources together. And so really, soil moisture, soil sensors are not the only game in town, and combining satellites and improved weather info to really drive some of those information decisions. So I've almost probably moved away from doing or putting too much emphasis on the soil moisture monitoring to now actually using your sort of satellite technologies to get into crop water use and using the the soil moisture to do point ground truthing of what's actually happening in your soil. So driving a lot of information, decision-making off the crop water use and using that to develop your water balance and then using soil moisture as a cross-check. So that's sort of that integrated of different data sources. So here, crop water use using your satellite and your weather info, the deposits, if you like, to your bank account, which is your irrigation and rainfall. So they sum up, that's your irrigation, your rainfall, sum up to total water use. One of the big challenges we had is getting irrigation controllers to talk to us and actually output what their run times are so we can actually convert that into a millimetres. rainfall, again, you can have a weather station, but, keeping the reliability of that weather station is really important. Again, a weather station is not a set and forget. It will require a lot of maintenance into it. And so that comes together to give you a water balance. So basically, these are your withdrawals. This is the crop water use. These are the water that's coming in terms of rainfall and irrigation. And then you have a soil water balance, basically. Are you drawing down, are you using the soil water up faster than it's coming in, in which case you're going to go into a negative. And basically the soil sensors in the ground are going to ground truth and tell you, is that realistic? Is this field capacity through here? And are you drying it down? And is your irrigation starting to increase that? So, you know, once you start to get to those things and you start to get to spatial stuff, you can start to use the spatial variability across the paddock combined with some soil moisture sensors to start to really are you losing yield? If so, how much is it worth to you? And start to make some real decisions. So I'm going to hand over to David for a more nursery orientated view of the world.
Thanks, Kelvin. Over to David from Greenlife Industry Australia.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the day. As they said, my name is David Hunt. I work for Greenlife Industries Australia. And today I'm going to give you an overview of the weight-based irrigation and leachate monitoring processes. What we're looking at is weight-based irrigation monitoring. Now, weight-based irrigation monitoring has been used in the past, and more so as a check mechanism in the nursery industry and the protected cropping industry. But it's becoming easier, as Kelvin said, with the advancement of technology and communication technologies. It is becoming easier and more usable, let's say. So what is weight-based irrigation monitoring? Basically, it's using the container weights to identify the water held within the growing media and also to help identify the plant's water use. As you could imagine, in containerized production nursery, the plants have a very limited root zone. The volume of growing media or potting mix in the container is all they have, and therefore monitoring the moisture content and the nutrient levels within that container are vital to producing a healthy plant. So this is looking at it from a very refined point of view and helping to refine irrigation scheduling. So why would you use weight-based irrigation monitoring over soil moisture sensors? Soil moisture sensors are definitely worthwhile using in larger containers. We have had them in containers before and they do work. And there are some nurseries out there that are using them. But with weight-based irrigation, it's more for seedling and plug trays where you've got very small volume of growing media or small containers where the actual container itself is quite small. Either it's too small for a soil moisture sensor to be put into, or the area of measurement that soil moisture sensor is monitoring is greater than the actual volume of the container. Therefore, you're going to be getting influences from outside the container. So using weight base helps to remove that error. Another thing too in nursery and protected cropping is that we use a lot of organic growing media, such as coir or in some cases rock wool and that sort of media. They tend to have a high airfield porosity. So it's really large air volumes within the actual growing media. And some of the soil moisture sensors don't like having large air pockets. They prefer to have a much more closed growing media. So if you are going to go down the path of looking at using soil moisture sensors in containerized production, make sure that those sensors are compatible with the growing media that you're using. Not all sensors can be used in organic growing media. But the benefit of using weight-based is also that it can help you to identify the water holding capacity of a container or the growing media for the water balance calculations. There's a little chart there that just shows the water loss per millimetre in different container sizes. So that relates the millimetre of water applied to weight loss in a container. One of the other benefits of using weight-based irrigation is that it's non-invasive. It doesn't interfere with the root growth. In some cases in the past where I've used soil moisture sensors, the roots have grown around the soil moisture sensor and it's been quite difficult to remove it from the pot. In this case, you can remove plants very easily, especially if you've got short cropping cycles. So it helps to reduce the labour requirements in that regard. The other thing of using weight-based irrigation is that you can refine your irrigation practices to allow the media to dry out more, to increase the actual air exchange or gas exchange and oxygen exchange within the growing media. Previous studies using weight-based irrigation monitoring or weight-based irrigation automation has shown that we can reduce the water use on a standard timed irrigation by about 40%. And in certain situations, you can reduce the water use by about 24% on evapotranspiration or ET controlled irrigation. Not only that, it will also help to reduce nutrient loss out of the container by 10 to 40%. And that's purely through refining the irrigation and reducing the amount of water that's leaching through the pot. In these previous studies, we've found that once the system's set up, there is no quality difference or marketability difference between the plants. It's still that you can still produce a highly marketable plant with reduced water quality, with reduced water volumes. So how do we determine what the actual irrigation triggers are in a weight-based system? You need to do a water holding capacity test and an airfield porosity test. Now, they're not specifically just for weight-based irrigation. There are really good tests to do to understand what your growing media is holding, how much water it can hold, how much air spaces there are in there. That'll help you to refine irrigation scheduling irrespective of what irrigation method, scheduling method you're using. But the idea is that you conduct a water holding capacity test to identify what those irrigation triggers are. And just the standard starting points would be, wilt point 20%, irrigation start would be about 40, irrigation stop would be about 60%, and then of course, container capacity is 100%. And to determine those actual percentages or weights, you can use either a scientific method, which uses the gravimetric weight method to soak the pot, saturate it, capture the leachate, do the calculations, work out what the actual container weights are and how much moisture is held within that growing media, and then identify your irrigation weights or irrigation percentages from there. The other way of doing it is to use a field method, which is probably a little bit more attractive to a lot of people, where you actually choose four containers and you set them to that basic same trigger point. So one is wilt point where you never want your plant to get, so that triggers an alarm. You set one to 100% capacity, so that's your maximum. And then you wet up two pots. So you've got a minimum moisture content for where you want your irrigation to start and a maximum water content where you want your irrigation to stop. And again, as Kelvin said, it is not a set and forget like any irrigation system. Once you've set your irrigation controller and you've worked out what your weights are, you have to monitor the irrigation events and adjust and refine the irrigation trigger points. And it's really not much different to timed in the sense that once you have your trigger points, changing your stop point, so holding your start point and changing your stop point is very similar to actually changing your time from an hour to half an hour or 5 minutes to 2 minutes. And there's a little graphic there to show in a previous trial that I've done where it shows what the millimeters of water is, the weight, and what the percentage of those stop points are. And they tend to work quite well. So this is an example. This is a composite that I put together of the graphs that we're getting from the control tower. As you can see on the top there, that is basically a soil moisture zone graph, where the green zone is where we want to keep our soil moisture, and that's basically set for the soil moisture sensors. The orange zone is to be a warning zone, that's dangerous, and the blue zone is to contain a capacity. The black line running along there shows what the average soil moisture content is for that container, and the blue columns are rain events. So if we compare that to the bottom graph, which is the purple line is the soil moisture sensor data, and the yellow line is the weight-based data coming from that graphic that Kelvin showed earlier with the six plants sitting on a weight scale. And as you can see, that the trends in the data pretty much parallel each other. We're getting that same spike as an irrigation or rain event occurs. We're getting the diurnal fluctuations and the dry down as the plant transpires and uses water. And it also helps us to identify where the container hits capacity. So you can see where that red rectangle is. The rain event has pushed the soil moisture to above container capacity, and you can actually see it in the graph below. Both the soil moisture and the weight data is showing that the data spikes. So the weight and the soil moisture spikes and drops back down pretty much immediately. That's indicating that the container is full and whatever water's going in is running out the bottom of the pot or container. So it's leaching all of your nutrients and wasting water at the bottom of your container. So that's a very basic overview of soil weight-based irrigation compared to soil moisture. As I said, either system works really well. It's just a matter of horses for courses, which system suits your situation. Of course, you can't use weight-based in a in-ground production facility or farm. But the next thing I wanted to talk about briefly was the leaching fraction. So leachate, of course, is what is flushed out or runs out of the bottom of the container, or what it runs off a growing area after irrigation or rain event. And in the nursery industry, we tend to target a leaching fraction of around about 12 to 20%. Ideally, we'd like it down around about the 12, but up until recently, trying to do any form of real-time leachate monitoring was near impossible. The old method was basically a pot in pot, where you would have to run an irrigation event, capture that leachate, and then measure it after the fact and do the calculations. Where in the new method that we're trialing at the Smart Production Nursery, we have a tipping bucket situation where we're capturing the application, the irrigation application, what's running into the pot, what's actually being applied in general. And that is near real time. Hopefully, as this is refined, we will be able to get it to a stage where it can actually influence or guide irrigation scheduling in real time. So some of the benefits of doing monitoring your leaching fraction and adjusting irrigation is that you can actually reduce the amount of water usage or runoff by reducing the amount of runoff or leachate or leaching. You can actually reduce your nutrient losses by about 10 to 40%. Now that is dependent upon the type of irrigation system you have, its efficiency and the application rate that you use. But that 12% leaching fraction has been identified as being a minimum requirement to stop any sort of salts building up in the root zone. And as I said before, because we have a very limited root zone or growing media volume, we're very conscious of not allowing those salts to build up because it can interfere with the health and development of the plant. It also helps from an environmental point of view that if you can reduce the amount of leaching from containers, it's going to reduce the amount of nutrients being leached into local waterways or storage dams. In the past, where we've had high nutrient leaching into waterways or storage dams, there's been a large algal bloom events, and that can also cause dam inversions where the water in the dam inverts and basically pulls up all the rubbish on the bottom of the dam and reduces the water quality. So by monitoring your leaching fraction and monitoring your leachate, you can actually reduce the amount of nutrients lost out of containers. So that means there's more nutrients within the root zone for plants to access and less of it going down waterways or into the storage dam that then requires treatment before using again. The other small, or not small actually, the other benefit that you can get from reducing your irrigation scheduling is that it helps to reduce your pump run times and therefore saves energy. There's a little schematic there also that shows how that tipping bucket system works. Quite simple when you think about it, but never been before used or developed before. So the other thing that I wanted to briefly touch on while we're talking about leachate is leachate monitoring. If you're capturing the leachate, whether it be the old method or the new method, if you're capturing leachate, then while you've got that leachate, it's worthwhile testing that leachate to keep an eye on how much is being leached through the containers. So you can use pH and EC sensors, as we've got here in the Smart Production Nursery, where we're actually monitoring the pH and EC of that leachate. So that provides us with an indication of how many nutrients are actually being leached out of the container. And if you don't have that automated version, which gives you a graph, you can actually use a desktop photometer, and you can then target specific nutrients, whether it be nitrates or phosphates and that sort of thing. And that's a really good way of actually being able to identify what's being leached, but not only that, whether or not what's being leached into local waterways meets environmental standards and water quality standards. So that's pretty much it, but further information if anybody's interested, as Kelvin has said, there is always the Smart Farming Technology Guide for Horticulture that will cover on some of this and give you links to resources where there are videos, and the Australian Plant Production Standards website that has a technical library with a variety of other information on conducting these tests and refining irrigation. So that's pretty much it from me. So thank you. And I will now hand over to Dallas.
Thanks, David. So I'm going to introduce Dallas Gibb, who will be discussing the visualization and interpretation of soil moisture data and also automating irrigation. So on to you, Dallas. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Henry. And hi, everyone. Thanks very much for joining the webinar. Just go to full screen. So the idea of collating all that data is part of the project where Hitachi Vantara was developing the smart farming tools. So that digital solutions is the focus of today's discussion in improving water management. So the first context is Hitachi's called it the control tower. The control tower doesn't mean a physical tower. It means a digital platform that gives you control in one location. In this case, for digital solutions around water management. So why focus on water management? Given Hitachi is a commercial company, it really needs to focus on developing digital solutions that obviously provide value proposition to the users. So what are some of those productivity drivers? So water management is obviously a key driver to productivity. If we don't get our water management accurate enough, it's going to cost us money, not only in wasted water, but also in reduced crop productivity. And that's particularly the case where sensitive crops, where you're in a nursery crop, where you have to really make sure that you're getting your watering as accurate as possible. The other productivity driver is obviously a global issue, is the skill shift is towards more business management in agricultural systems. There's less labor resources out there. So farmers, business owners need to become smarter. And the way they can do that is have a look at the integrated data solutions that provide intelligence in real time around crop intelligence. So they can make decisions based on that data. And they can make those decisions based on the data where they're sitting, coming from the field, rather than having to walk into the field or the nursery. The crucial element for that is obviously real-time data and data insights that relate to decision-making. So when we've developed a solution for the project, we actually started with a blank piece of paper and we asked the users, what type of decisions do they want? And then we map back through that, well, what data is required to make those decisions. The other key productivity driver is obviously labor, as I mentioned before. So the opportunity is, and the feedback we've got from all the growers that we've used is potential replacement of labor through automated systems and control systems. So linking the data to automated control systems, which I'll touch on. And then the final one, which is obvious for all growers, is the higher cost of production. And this obviously relates to water management. So we have the increasing cost of water, whether dollars per megalitre, And specifically that relates, if you're pumping water, is obviously energy use, and we now all know energy costs are going up. Fertilizer use and fertigation. So if you're using irrigation systems for fertilizer, it's that, you know, we don't want to waste water because then we're wasting nutrients and the cost of nitrogen is certainly increasing. So we don't want to waste that. And then, as I've mentioned before, labor resources to reduce labor. So the task that we had was to develop a fully integrated platform. So it wasn't just about soil water. We've developed an integrated system that looks at full farm productivity, but also linking that farm productivity to activities and tracking activities on farm, whether they're tractors or individuals, and then tracking that produce right through to the processing shed and then to the packing, and then from the packing shed right through to the retailer, all on one single platform so the user can see all that coming, what's happening on farm, but also where the produce is going off farm. So that was the task, to develop a single integrated platform. This is the example of a slide from the control tower showing a banana farm. We can see here on the left-hand side all the elements of the control tower as it exists now. So we do have crop production, we do have supply chain tracking as an example, operations tracking, as well as weather alerts, thresholds, and system settings. So we're talking around irrigation and water management today, but the control tower has been built around a full farm integration system. So the visualization map here is simply showing the fields. The colors mean the status of those fields related to the plant available water. Obviously blue means it's over irrigated, green means it's ideal, and red is reaching a threshold or has reached a threshold for plant available water. These are locations for the individual sensors. The way Hitachi maps the data and data processing, there are four core elements by which we analyze data. The first one is obviously providing real-time insights and real-time recommendations. That's obviously a standard requirement for all data management. Then the next level is short-term planning. So looking at that short-term, that seven-day forecast, trying to plan what's going to happen in the next week based on that data. The highest level next is scenario planning. So looking further forward into the future, but also using more advanced crop modeling. And that in some of the activities we've done, managing irrigation through looking at weather data, crop evapotranspiration into the future, et cetera. In the future, we'll be looking at growing degree days of crops and marrying that up with the weather data to try to plan where the crop will be at certain times, planning the water budgets around those times. So the growers can produce their water budgets more accurately and adjust it in real time. Then the fourth stage is process improvement. So the process there is process orchestration. So you look at scenarios, but you also look at back at time and forward at time for process improvement. And to if you have a particular process by which you're making decisions, to look at that process in a digital form, make sure it's being complied to. So they're the four core elements. As I said, the core value propositions, and these are some of the value propositions which we've noticed from a solution. Obviously in irrigation management, all users have seen a decrease in water use, or they've changed their irrigation strategy based on the data. Water quality and improvements. So managing water quality in terms of irrigation has fundamentally changed as a result of the digital solutions. Managing fertigation. So the step is to look at fertigation, look at the concentration of nutrients and salts in the plant and monitor that and change the fertigation related to the crop use and plant stress, but also ECs in the root zone, and to manage that EC or that salinity level in the root zone, and to marry irrigation up with fertigation requirements. And obviously the last one is very important given the cost, is labor management. So less time manually checking plants. The growers that have used the system have got confidence now. So now they're not running around the field or driving and spending hours in the field. They've become confident in the solution that we've provided. So they're able to spend more time making other business decisions. And obviously the labor management, the whole future there is potentially full automation So they're reducing the time for the irrigation manager. So he can monitor, but he doesn't actually have to control anything. That can happen automatically. So digital solutions for irrigation, the core options are water balance model, and all these elements are done within the control tower digitally. So water balance model, irrigation planning tools, soil moisture sensors, EC and salinity around the root zone, water quality data, fertigation rates, leachate and runoff, as David sort of mentioned. And we're also measuring plant growth, which is a session for another webinar. The advanced tools are water budgeting, water demands, so short-term planning, as I mentioned before, integrated data solutions and prediction tools around crop water use, linking crop data to water use and soil water availability, and then linking irrigation control systems to allow full automation. So they're the tools which have come out of the program. Just to give you a highlight of some of the examples within the control tower, the water balance model. So this is managing irrigation without sensors. So as Kelvin mentioned, we're using ETO from the weather data. So evapotranspiration, we're combining that with crop factors. And the crop factors are published factors, or individual growers wanted to be able to change their individual crop factors to give a prediction of crop water use. And then obviously we can do an irrigation plan on a water balance model. You can put in your irrigation plan in millimetres. Then we're capturing real-time data and plus predicted weather data to be able to plan the future. And then that all those elements are turned into a predicted end date and for the end of the day, the plant available water at the end of the day to give a grower an indication. So all that can happen within the control tower without deploying any sensors. And we can marry that up with water budgeting in terms of the percentage of water use compared to budget. When we look at soil sensors, the digital solutions provide a real-time image of the soil profile by sensors. In this case, there were five sensors deployed at various depths, and we can see the change in water at those various depths. We also get an indication of the percentage of plant available water, how much water is there, and its change over the last 24 hours, the daily water use rate, and the days to refill point, or the days to the next irrigation plan. So all that's happening in real time and changing based on weather data, soil water information is all collated to provide these solutions. The next level is to detect where the water is relative to your plant available water. So in this case here, we have the different profiles down the root zone, and we can see percentage of plant available water used. So we can see here in this case, at the top 10 centimetres, it's 114%. We've actually used all the water. We're down at depth because they're using pulse irrigation. The depth water has remained above threshold, if you like, and it's on -4, which indicates it's above plant available water. So in this case, in this profile, there's plenty of water at depth, but very limited water in the upper section. So again, it helps the irrigation manager plan his irrigation schedule. The advanced planning, the advanced modeling takes into account plant growth, soil water models, weather data, forecast rainfall data, and current and crop water use factors or crop factors. So they're all combined to give predictive tools to be able to plan and forecast predictions of water use over any sort of set period for which you want, depends on the crop. In this case, you know, 1, 3, and 10 days. They're visualized here in this dial, in a very simple to interpret dial, where you have current plant available water, the end of the day, and at 3 days time. So very simple interactive tools that can be able to be used. Fertigation and root zone. Again, this is an example of a UI which has been used on the nursery to measuring fertigation rates, but also EC and salinity in pots. And again, we can deploy this around sensitive vegetable crops as well to give an indication of the root zone salinity, particularly with shallow rooted crops. So the orange line here is the soil moisture, so we can see where they've irrigated, etc. sorry, going this way. So we've irrigated and it declines irrigation, etc. So we can see here in salinity, it was increasing quite rapidly through a fertigation event. And the grower was concerned about that rapid rise. So he's increased the irrigation and leached that salinity out of the pot and then maintained that throughout here. And then he's increased his fertigation again. And so he's able to monitor that change in EC and salinity in the pot. And as he's done here, he's reduced his fertigation to reduce that salinity level and then started the cycle again. So it's a very useful tool in changing fertigation rates with irrigation. The final step in managing water is full automation. So combining all those tools which I mentioned and a further tool, which is real-time monitoring of plant stress, which this graph here is a dendrometer data, which is again session for another webinar. So we're combining plant data, soil mortar data, EC, doing predictive tools, combining weather data, and to make a prediction of when and how much water should be irrigated, and then marrying that up, in this case, a Dream 2 irrigation control system, where the grower has an irrigation plan. We marry the data to compare it against the irrigation plan and then make a recommendation to the grower to change or the current plan is suitable. If there's a recommended change, the system would send an alert to the grower saying there's a system change recommended. Do you want to proceed with the system change? And then that could be implemented automatically, or he can accept or decline that recommendation from the system. So that's all I have. Thanks, Henry and Liam.
Thank you, Dallas. And thank you all to all the presenters, and thank you to the pilot farm operators. It's now over to the question and answer session. So please type your questions into the question and answer function at the bottom of Zoom, and we can answer them for you. We have one question to start, perhaps for Kelvin. What do you find is holding growers back from using soil moisture technology?
I mean, there's been a long history of using soil moisture. A lot of times I find that people will use them for a year or so and effectively use them as a way of calibrating their eye, and then they end up in the shed again. I think that's a pretty common occurrence I see. Some of it's the lack of, I guess, the turnover of staff. And I think Dallas referred to that is one of the issues we see with irrigation is as soon as you go to the technology approach is it requires a high level of skill. And we know that the turnover of staff and the change between staff make it difficult to manage that data flow. So that's one of the issues. There's the maintenance issue as well. They are not a set and forget. Particularly in a veggie crop where you're pulling them in and out is another disincentive to using them. So there are a couple of reasons. We've certainly looked at this in the past and, you know, generally about roughly a third of growers tend to be using these tools, and then probably another third have used them in the past and used them to, I guess, calibrate their eye and learn from them. And then they've adjusted their irrigation technique and then they sort of keep going with the spade and the observation of the crop. While Dallas is all about automation, I said, you know, generally the good growers I see are usually two people. One's really good at observing the crop and the other one's really good at the technology. And when you get a pair like that together, you see really good improvements. So while we might want to automate everything, there's still a lot to be said for getting out and looking at the crop and the soil.
Thank you, Kelvin. We have a question for Dallas. Does your system use AI when forecasting weather within the local microclimate?
Yeah, good question. In terms of microclimate, so we do have weather stations deployed at all the farms, including the nursery. So we are capturing real-time weather data at that local level. and managing that and using that data and comparing that data with the long-term weather forecast data, or particularly initially over the next 7 days from the local weather stations, and comparing that data with the local weather station data. In terms of AI, we're combining all that data with the soil moisture data. And that happens every 15 minutes. So the predictions change every 15 minutes based on the change in soil moisture data, based on the change in weather data as well. So it's happening, that those algorithms are happening in real time.
Thank you, Dallas. Perhaps a question for anyone on the line. Is there any indication of costs of moisture monitoring systems?
I'll start. I mean, you can start with a pretty simple one that probably $1,000 will get you something to start with. And then obviously you can build on that. And really the whole idea of this project was, certainly my experience, if I'm doing some work, I'll have a website open for the satellite imagery, so the NVDI. I'll have a website open for soil moisture. I'll have a website open for the weather, and you're trying to do it in your head. You're trying to do the integration in your head, and you know that just does your head in. And so the idea is really trying to bring all these data sources together. And so there are systems you can build to start with, and then build into a major smart farming type platform. And I guess one of the issues that we faced in this project was, and Dallas will talk about it, is you know, getting the technology to talk to a platform, an independent platform.
Yeah. So, you know, I agree with everything with Kelvin said. I think one of the first decisions that growers make is how many sensors they actually need, how uniform is their crop, how uniform are their soil types, and that will determine really how many sensors they actually need, and particularly from a cost point of view, how many communication nodes they require, because the actual communication node is a significant cost. So if we can reduce those number of nodes, then that will reduce the cost. In terms of deployment and the communication and integration of the data, again, what we've done is worked with the sensor provider that have developed APIs to be able to capture that data. So if you're trying to develop or if you're trying to deploy with a third party or even ourselves, that's one of the first questions we ask: has the sensor provider or has the sensors that you've deployed on your farm, does your provider actually have APIs to be able to capture that data automatically? If those APIs are not there, then there's a considerable cost to develop those. I will say that in the title of the project, none of the sensors are Hitachi's. They're all third-party sensors. So we're purely working on the digital solution, and they are third-party sensors that are available for everyone.
And I'll just make a comment that I agree with both Dallas and Kelvin, that you need to actually understand what you want from your sensor before you go out and buy something. But if you're unsure and you just want to start down this path, then you can certainly go and buy one of the sort of insertion sensor, the soil moisture sensors, something. There's a few of them out there that are handheld that you can insert them to get an idea. So you actually learn what it's telling you. And then once you start to get a grasp on that, going down the more fully integrated or automated path is the next step. So understand what you want from your sensor and your technology before you actually go out and buy something.
Thank you, David. We've got another question here. Does sensor data feedback to change fertigation rates automatically? Perhaps a question for Dallas.
Yeah, so the intent in the automation, it was a two-step process which we're developing. The first one is obviously automation of the irrigation based on soil moisture. And then the next phase is to marry that up with fertigation. So fertigation is obviously different to irrigation. You have to have a certain amount of runtime. And when you're fertigating, you have to make sure that you've got enough nutrient going on to the crop. And that obviously needs to correlate with your runtime for irrigation. So it really depends on marrying up how much nutrient you want to put on with each irrigation. And then, as we mentioned, what our focus on, particularly for the nursery, was to managing the EC in the pot. So we're marrying fertigation, irrigation up with the amount of nutrient and salinity around the root zone. So there, it's quite a complex task to marry up fertigation if you're trying to manage salinity around the root zone.
Thank you, Dallas. We have another question from Tony. Who owns the data that is collected under the subscription type programs? And does the grower have the ability to source aggregated data from other like type businesses?
Yeah. So the data is generally, there'd be a data sharing agreement as part of this project. There was a data sharing agreement that the growers had to approve. And that would be a standard commercial protocol where the growers would agree to share their data. And part of that data sharing would be the growers would agree to give access to the system to their agronomists if they want, et cetera, or different people on the farm that would have different access to the system and see that data. And that certainly goes to a point where one of the activities of the project was BMP reporting and audit reporting. And that obviously relates to fertilisation, fertigation and irrigation and water quality. So growers are asking, can the system provide access to third parties such as auditors to save them time and audit costs? So again, they're all related to data sharing agreements. But at the end of the day, the data initially is all owned by the grower or by the provider of that data. And that data can be accessed. It's purely raw data that we're receiving. The collation of the data and modeling of the data is perhaps a different question, but in terms of the raw data, that's owned by the provider.
As a broad question, the subscription models that a lot of companies now run, the grower maintains control of that data, and there's very limited scope, and I'll have to check this, but there's very limited scope for the overall platform runner to actually aggregate that up to provide that benchmarking that you're talking about, Tony. It's very useful to know how you're performing against others in your industry, but that's another level of data access and sophistication.
Thank you, Dallas and Kelvin. We have a question here from Daniel. Which type of sensors do you find most common and useful for in-field settings? Percentage probes, capacitance probes, etc.
Not quite clear on the question there, Dallas. I'm not sure whether you are. I mean, I think he's asking, is there, I think, normally your soil moisture probes will read out in volumetric water content. Mm-hmm. And so, you'll have a reading for the different probes down there, and then you can aggregate those up to a total amount of water in millimeters for your whole profile. And they both are very useful, and I'll often flick between the two. So if I'm doing a water balance model, I want to know the amount of water in the soil in millimeters, because rain comes down in millimeters. Crop water use is in millimeters per day, and you can convert your run times into millimeters. So if you get all those inputs and outputs in millimeters, it's very simple arithmetic to do a water balance. If you're wanting to look at, and it's very easy, and a lot of programs and a lot of interfaces will switch between the units. You just need to know percent by volume, by depth to switch. If you're wanting to know what's happening with, say, deep drainage or your subsoil, then you might look at a specific sensor and you might be looking at percent. And so I tend to think naturally in percent. I've got a feel, I know what 20% looks like, and I know what 10% looks like, so you tend to feel like that. I don't know if that's your experience, David, in terms of switching between them.
It's one of those things where I think people get a feel, like you said before, calibrating the eye. In the nursery industry, it's calibrating the finger. Most nursery people would go around and just put their finger into the pot to determine what the moisture is in the past, where now they're starting to look at the soil moisture probes. And depending on which probe you use, depends on whether you get the percentage or whether you get a millimeter and whether that's been calibrated to that growing medium. But yes, it's one of those things, like I said before, check that the system that you want to use is appropriate for the growing media or soil that you're going to use it in. That's the first point.
David, were you surprised at how well the soil moisture probes track the weight-based?
Personally, when I first started doing this work years ago, so it was quite surprising because it was just let's see if it does do it. And then when I first started using soil moisture probes, I used a capacitance sensor, and it was a little bit sort of awry. The readings didn't mean much, couldn't really relate it because it didn't like being in an organic growing media. And even after I did a calibration curve, it still didn't sort of parallel and didn't seem to work or look that good. But once I found a soil moisture sensor that would work well in an organic growing media, then we see what I showed up there before, that parallel between the soil moisture and the weight. And since then, it doesn't surprise me that it does mirror it, because I've seen similar sort of graphs for using like field lysimeters and that sort of thing related to EnviroScan soil moisture sensors, and they're very similar.
Mm-hmm. David, a follow-up question there. Is your nursery weight-based system compatible with irrigation controllers such as Priva?
Priva actually do produce a weight scale system in their protected cropping area industry for equipment. So they do have a weight-based monitoring device that will connect into the Priva system, and that is used in the, I suppose you'd say the AI, the programming. In general, can you buy a load cell or a weight-based system off the shelf and plug it into any irrigation controller? No. There has to be some form of communication calibration. So even though a load cell will produce a standard analog output, and if you get the raw data in, it will give you that diurnal sort of graph capability, but then the interface between the raw data and the irrigation control is the gap that needs to be bridged. And this is what Dallas and Hitachi are doing. There are some other systems out there that do bridge that gap. So I would, again, certainly suggest that if anybody is interested in doing this, that they do their research, have a look at what's out there, and then ask the questions as to whether it's being used and if they can go and have a look at it.
Thank you, David. Thank you, everyone. We might wrap it up there. So thank you, everyone, for joining the webinar today. This webinar was recorded, and we'll send out a recording to all the attendees. And please keep an eye out for a notification of our next webinar on dendrometers, which will be on the 11th of May. So thank you, everyone.
Thanks for everybody. Mm-hmm.